What's going on YouTube? In today's fantastic color grading tutorial, we are going to be talking about render cache. And I'm sure many of you guys don't really know the real benefits of render cache and why is it so important to keep that in mind, especially when you're working on certain projects. Now, today I'm going to be working with the footage from the raw film. Huge thank you to them for providing me this fantastic footage from DJI. Be sure to check them out. I'll put a link in the description below. So here we have a very nice drone shot of a very nice neighborhood. Looks like somewhere either in Santa Barbara or LA. And it looks very nice, clean, and cinematic. So the first thing I'm gonna do before we really gonna dive deep into render cache, I'm just gonna give it a nice basic look. Okay, let me drop my LUT really quick on it so we have something that we're gonna work. Okay, really quick, let's drop it down a bit so we have all information there. Okay, so here we have it. If I'm gonna click playback, we can see that we still get 30 frames a second, which is natural frame rate of this clip. Now things are gonna start changing a little bit once we gonna start adding things. Now in the first note, and again, I'm doing it just as a crude example to slow down my computer so you guys can see, I'm gonna add few things. So this is gonna be an R noise reduction. This is gonna be LUT. Let me do a little bit of tracking over here. So for this one, I'm gonna track a house. Okay, let's make it look nice and cool. Okay, so let's track this really quick. And we can see, by the way, how noise reduction already takes toll on the whole computer. Even though I'm using Threadripper processor, it's still taking huge toll on performance. And I'm gonna explain to you and show it to you why is it so important not to have this kind of performance drop going on in just 1 second. Okay, let's this thing finish really quick and we'll move forward. By the way, if you guys hear a little bit wind, I apologize. It's almost 100 degrees right now. It's super hot outside. Okay, so this one we're gonna call tracking. Let's play it back really quick and see where we're at. Okay, so we got about 13 frames a second, which is not really good. And this whole argument comes from, I know a lot of users, especially those laptop Apple fanboys, gonna say, oh, I get awesome performance, no problem there. Well, here's the real issue, what happens when you don't get real-time performance, okay? And I'm gonna demonstrate to you. So here we have this clip. Let's say I'm picking the secondaries. Okay, and let's pick something ridiculous like this road. Okay, something like that. Okay, looks fine. Let's say, for the sake of tutorial, let's kind of color it a little bit so we can see. Okay, so something like this. Okay, we change the color so it looks nice. Well, what happens, people scroll like this and they think, oh, okay, everything looks good. Next frame. Okay, fair enough. If we're gonna play it back, you also don't see it. But what really happens when you don't get the real-time performance, we're gonna go to the highlights. What happens that you get crazy noise like this. Okay, like artifacts like that. So until you're actually looking at this in the real time, you cannot see it. It's just not there. Okay, let me zoom in over here. It's just simply not there. So let me show it to you. Let's go in the settings really quick and optimize media and render cache. We have few settings. I always recommend using your cache drive, a special dedicated drive, to be SSD. Regular HDD no longer cut it. They're slow, they're clunky. So it's not a good option to have regular hard drives. Now, depending on your computer, depending how powerful your computer is, you can change this to other format. If you're working in the Apple ecosystem, you're probably going to have ProRes. The thing is, why DNX HR on the PC and the ProRes on the Apple? Because both of them are intermediate codecs. That means those codecs designed specifically for color work, for visual effects work, and also they designed to be delivery codecs. That's why they're called intermediate. So basically, you can deliver using those codecs, and you can go back and forth using the very same. Now, again, depending on the computer and the speed of your drive, you may drop this a little bit, or you can increase it, again, depending on what kind of system you have. By default, HQX, fantastic. If you want things to be a little bit faster, HQ is also a fantastic choice. Now, enable background caching after 5 seconds. What it does, if you're not touching your mouse for 5 seconds, it's going to start automatically calculating. What I normally like to do to change 5 to 1, basically 1 second. So the moment you let go of your mouse, the computer will start doing its calculation. So let's click save. Nothing happens. Well, the reason for that, you have to select and basically enable the whole render caching. So go to playback, and under the playback, you can see render cache smart and user. The difference between them, user, you manually select the clip that you want to be render cached. Smart is computer automatically detects the clips that cannot be played back in real time, and it starts render caching. So let me bring the clip. So here we have the clip. Once we're going to go into render cache and select smart, we can see that immediately the time code turned red. That means this clip is currently render caching in the background. If we're going to go into edit, we can also actually see this little red line appear on top of the clip that's being cached. And the blue indicates the amount of the caching that's been done to selected clip or a timeline. It's very straightforward, very simple, but I'm going to show it to you how you can, in a obviously brutal perspective, work with that and why is it so important to see. Okay, almost done. Again, depending on computer, it will affect your speed. So now it's finally done. Let's go back on the color. So now if we're going to go in the full screen, we can actually see, let me bring it up, the dancing noise that's located on this hill over here. And I'm hoping that YouTube compression will allow you to see it, because I certainly can see it on my screen, and I'm hoping the YouTube will allow you to see it too, but I doubt it a little bit because it's probably going to be too finesse. But you can see it, it's dancing. When you have choppy playback, you cannot see that. So what happens, you think you're done, you think your computer handle it, you submit this back, and then the client or whoever gonna tell you, hey, you know, what's going on down there? And basically, this is the whole point of render caching, to make your playback fluid so you can see exactly in real time what are you doing. The whole argument that even if your computer's slow and you're kind of scrubbing through timeline and you think it looks good, is not cutting in a professional work environment, especially if you do a lot of secondaries and more finesse selection. So it's very important, again, to see everything in real time. That's how you spot bad selection and artifacts caused by secondaries. So hopefully this cleaned up a little bit the idea why you need to do render caching, again, depending on the project and the budget. But I hope you guys understand the concept. Thank you for watching, and I'm going to see you next time. Take care.